They forced themselves on me. Here I was a virgin. They tore me apart, literally. I'm now homeless. I've been chased out of the house. I've been diagnosed with HIV. Nobody to talk to, nowhere to go. I just wanted to die.
15 years ago, one morning, Mama Nancy knocked on her bedroom door and told her that she was going to the market. What Nancy did not know is that the mom would never come back. It has been 15 years. She does not know where her mother is, and a lot of things have happened in her life. She still wonders where she is. And today's story is just a story of a woman who has gone through so many challenges, but the resilience she's carried through this is what we're here to celebrate today. Karibu sana Nancy to the show.
Asante sana.
Tuambie from your childhood, what has been your life like, na umekuja hapa kutuelezea a story of hope.
Yeah.
So how was your life beginning pale chini ukiwa mdogo?
First, my name is Nancy Bosibori.
Mm-hmm.
I'm 32 years old. I'm a mom of one. Yeah, I'm a businesswoman.
Okay.
I'm the firstborn in a family of five. We were raised, most of our lives, we were raised in Nairobi. So my mom, my dad, and my four siblings, and the five of us.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we were just a happy family, a normal family, an average one, not high class, not low class. Yeah,
yes.
Just an average family. Life started getting hard, a bit hard when in 2008, when one morning, mom woke up and she knocked on my door and she told me, Nancy, when you get up, make breakfast for your siblings. I'm going to the market, I'm coming. It was just a normal day because my mom was a businesswoman also. And she used to go to the market every day.
So for you, even that morning, it was normal for her to tell you?
Yeah, it was just a normal morning.
Mm-hmm.
There was nothing unusual. So when she knocked on my door, I didn't even bother to open the door, check what mom was carrying maybe, mm-hmm. what she was wearing, or even have a talk with her. Mom, are you sure you're going to the market? Because, yeah. So I didn't open the door. I continued sleeping. I was like, yes, mom, I'll do that. So she left. I continued sleeping because it was 5 a.m. in the morning. So later on, when we saw the time was, the day has ended, mom isn't coming back, we decided to call her. Her line wasn't going through.
At that time, Baba kwa ameshajua that your mom hayuko around anymore because then mko adogo and the person who was supposed to kwenda sokoni akuje hajarudi. Mlikuwa msha alert anyone?
No, we didn't alert anybody immediately because even if you report it, it's supposed to be, you give it like 48 hours.
Right.
Yeah.
So it was not concerning at that point.
Yeah, and we couldn't even imagine that that was the last time we saw our mom,
right.
You know.
Mm-hmm.
It was not in our minds. It never clicked.
Mm-hmm.
We were happy. Okay, they were having their own problems, mom and dad, but we never thought that it would drive mom to go away and never come back, you know.
Yeah.
So after like 2 days, that's when it dawned on us that mom is not coming back. And dad decided to, okay, he told us he went looking for her. He said he went to the police station, reported the matter, and he was told to wait. So at the back of my mind, I thought maybe mom had gone to the up country to her home. And that she would come back, you know. But she never came. Till date, 15 years.
So you're the firstborn. You immediately have to assume the role of parenting these other younger siblings.
Yes.
How was life, you know, for you? You've just cleared
high school.
Mm-hmm. You're expecting someone to guide you through the adult life.
Yes.
But here you are. So how's life treating you at this point?
Oh my God, life never remain the same again.
Mm-hmm.
I had to assume the mom role now. Dad remarried soon after, and he went with his new wife to a different location to live there. So we were left alone at home, myself and my four siblings. Yeah. So it was hard, it was hard. Dad deserted us at that moment.
Yeah.
We had to even beg for food from neighbors, you know. We had tenants living, we had our own house and tenants. We were eating from the tenants, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
At one point, I remember I went to the DO's office to report the case, because now I'm the first one. I can't just sit around and watch my siblings sleep hungry, you know. And my dad was so mad at me. He was so mad. He even chased me away from home. Yeah, so we had some disagreements for some time, for the longest time, that period, 2008 to like 2010.
Yeah.
We had disagreements with my dad. And I didn't get help because he works for the government, you know. Mm. So it was like they were siding with him. They didn't listen to my story, so we had to go live at, we had an aunt, but she passed on last year.
Mm-hmm.
She lived in Ruiru. So we had to run to her place, because now if we report the case, nothing happens, no help comes. We feed from the neighbors till they get tired of us, you know. So life went on like that till, okay, my younger ones were still schooling.
Yeah.
So at least we were suffering while during the holidays, but after the schools opened, they would go back to school, and now I was left alone.
So would your dad still pay school fees for your siblings?
I had to push him. Mm. I had to push him. Yeah, but some people talked to him and
he obliged.
Yeah, he obliged at some point. Mm-hmm. And yeah, now he had a problem with me. Now that I was not schooling, I was home. He didn't want to take me to college. So he said he would look for work for me. I was just 18. I'm expecting to go to college. Now my dad is saying, you'll have to go to college. You'll have to work.
Mm-hmm.
You can then proceed learning by yourself, you pay for yourself, you mm-hmm. see. Later on in 2010, something happened that changed my life completely.
Mm-hmm.
Our house was raided one fateful night. Four armed robbers came in, they stole, and later on, two of them, they came, they forced themselves on me. Here I was, a virgin. They tore me apart, literally. It was so traumatizing. And there was nobody to talk to, nobody to come to my rescue. After they were done, they left. I just stayed there crying. I didn't get out of the house for like a whole week. Yeah, a whole week. I didn't get out of the house.
Which means you didn't even go to seek for treatment.
No, I didn't go to seek treatment. I was naive. First of all, I was naive. I didn't know how to deal with a situation like that.
Yeah.
Second, I was in too much pain. I couldn't even walk. Third, I was in shock. I was still in shock. I was just traumatized.
I can imagine.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So after 2 weeks is when the aunt from Ruiru came to visit us. That's when she discovered I had been raped. She took me to the hospital, but nothing could be done because it was too late.
Yeah.
So the doctors just, they give me painkillers to ease my pain, and yeah, They told me to go back after 3 months to do the checkups, if maybe I had contracted any disease. They did the pregnancy test. I wasn't pregnant. Of course, I couldn't be pregnant that time, but they had to check after a while. So after 3 months, we went back to the hospital. All this time, my dad doesn't know whatever has happened. He didn't know. So they, after the 3 months, nothing was seen again. They told me again 3 months, so 6 months total. Now before the 6 months elapsed, before I could even go back to the hospital, Dad wanted to take me to a certain job. Okay. Yeah, a good paying job. But then they had to undertake a pregnancy test and a medical test. Yeah.
Those were the requirements before they handed you the job.
Yeah. So knowing my dad well, I didn't want to wait for the D-Day, go with him, do the testing, then maybe something comes along the way and...
I discover with him.
Mm-hmm. He was so brutal, at that moment. So I had that fear. So I went myself to the hospital. I told them, you have to do the tests before the 6 months, because now I have a job I have to go to. Please check me. Mm. Pregnancy, nil. Yeah. HIV. Oh my God. I received the shock of my life. Turned positive.
Did they break the news to you right there and then, or was there some sort of counseling to prepare you for the news?
They did a lot of counseling. Okay. I was like, why are these people wasting time? Their work is just to test me, give me the results, mm-hmm. then I go, because I couldn't imagine me turning positive, you know?
Yeah.
So the counseling sessions were too many, and they did numerous tests. Now they had done the pricking one.
Mm-hmm.
Now they wanted to do the
throw blood.
Yeah. So I was like, what is it? Is there something wrong, or are your equipments wrong, or what's happening? I hadn't seen the results yet. They hadn't shown me.
Yeah.
So after the counseling, that's when they told me, we are sorry, it turned positive. We've done numerous tests and they've all turned positive, but this life, it's not the end of life. That's right. What they were saying. No, me, I wasn't listening to this other part that it's not the end of life, mm-hmm. blah, 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 blah. I was still stuck at it turned positive. I was like, how? Your equipment must be very, very old, fake.
Yeah.
I went to different, in fact, the nurse was so good because I had gone there alone.
Yeah.
She was good enough to take me to different VCTs, 5 of them.
Yeah.
Because she saw the shock on me. She took me to they tested me. It was positive.
All this time you're trying to process and accept.
Yeah, I'm trying to process and I'm like, the only time I've had sex is those guys me. So I narrated to them the ordeal. And yeah, they confirmed it. Those guys had infected me.
So now, life to accept that has been...
Life turned around immediately. At an instant, life turned around. I imagine myself, how could I continue living with HIV? How? I'd rather be dead than live. What would I be living for? How can I even invest? How can I work? who will I be working for? You see? How will I have a family? How can I have children? Who will take care of them? Even if, even if I want to continue my education, who will I be learning for? You see? It was just a death sentence for me. Mm-hmm. So I just went home. Again, I locked myself in my room crying. All this time, even my aunt now doesn't know. Yeah, doesn't know, because she had gone back to her place and now I was alone.
And this aunt is sister to your mom or your dad?
To my dad.
Right.
So my dad was like, are we still going for the recruitment? I told him, no, we are not going. He was shocked. How? Why? Why don't you want to go? And he had
made all the arrangements.
Yeah, all the arrangements. Mm-hmm. He had given out some huge amount of money for me to be recruited. He was mad. He literally disowned me. He told me, if I can do all this for you and you just turn it off. Mm-hmm. No, you just look for somewhere else to go, leave my house, you just go. Mm-hmm. Now here I was, I'm now homeless, I've been chased out of the house, I've been diagnosed with HIV, nobody to talk to, nowhere to go. I just wanted to die. Yeah, mm-hmm. Just wanted to die. So I went to a friend's house, to their family house. I stayed there, but I couldn't tell anybody. I couldn't disclose whatever was eating me up. Mm. Accepting was so hard. In fact, I came to accept 4 years later in 2014. That's when I decided, okay, this thing has happened. There's no going back.
Yeah.
It cannot be reversed. I have to live. I have to know how to live from here, you know.
Yeah.
And I didn't want to have, what is it called? Those sores people have, the loss of hair.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I didn't want people now to see that, oh, Nancy is infected. So I went back to the hospital. I told them, okay, now I'm ready. We can commence the treatment. But I didn't mean it that I'm ready. No, I was just scared of death.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I just didn't want to die.
And they did help you?
Yeah, they helped me to some extent, but I hadn't fully accepted, so I just took the medication.
Mm-hmm.
I could just take like a week and then I stopped taking. In fact, I used to throw them away because I could have so many, they expire. I throw them. I decided I can even take my own life. I tried suicide.
No.
Yes, I tried it.
At this point, this is just the stress that's coming from this diagnosis and trying to accept. It's a whole process.
Yes, it's a whole process. And I blamed my dad entirely for everything. All that time, I was blaming my dad. I was like, if your dad, if you didn't wrong mom, she wouldn't have gone. These thieves wouldn't have come. They wouldn't have done this to me. And you wouldn't have left home to go live with your new wife elsewhere. You would have been home and we would be safe. Everything would be just fine. So every blame, I put it on dad, you see. So I didn't even tell him, I didn't see the need to tell him that I've been diagnosed with this and this, because I didn't even want to see him at that moment. Dad came and found out. He had the habit of peeping through my bags, my suitcases. Yeah, he was the overprotective type. So he wanted to see what is happening with this girl. Why is she mad suddenly? Why is she not happy? So she found the bottle, ARV's bottle. I was out. That time I wasn't there. So when I came back, he sat me down. He told me, Nancy, you know you're my daughter. And that day, he wasn't shouting the way he usually shouted. Yeah. He talked so calmly. And I was shocked. Why is that talking this way? And he had disowned me.
Mm-hmm. Even chased you out of your
house. Yeah, he chased me out of the house. What is happening? Is he changing or something? Mm-hmm. Is he saved now or what is happening? Mm-hmm. He told me, why should you go through a lot of stress alone? Mm-hmm. While we are here, your family, we are here. Why don't you talk to us? I was like, what? Why are you telling me that? What kind of stress? I'm okay. He told me, no. I went through your bags and I found this. Now he brought it out. Oh my God. I've never been shocked that way. He's the last person I wanted to know about my state. Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Because I knew if he finds out, he will now kill me. You see? I knew if Dad knows about this, he will literally kill me and chase me out of the house now completely. So I didn't want him to. I had hidden it.
But he found
out. Yeah, very far. Mm-hmm. But he found out. And he had gone to the chemist to ask about the content, what it was. He didn't know. So he told me, I found this and I know what it means. But you shouldn't be killing yourself inside with such kind of stress. I'm here, I'm still your dad, and I love you.
Wow.
Yes. I couldn't believe it, you know? Mm-hmm. It was a shock. He encouraged me. He told me, there are people we've been working with since way back 1990s. They're living positively and they are very okay. Mm-hmm. And you can't even tell if they're positive or not, you know. So, yeah, since that time, now my dad started being so supportive. He changed his attitude towards me, even towards my young ones.
Yeah.
He completely changed his attitude. So later on, I met somebody. No, somebody met me. I wasn't looking.
Wow, somebody met you.
Yeah, somebody met me. Uh-huh. He proposed. But I was like, you guys, do you know what you're getting yourself into? You shouldn't be loving me.
You are not ready for this.
Yeah, and I thought, I was like, you can't love me. I'm HIV positive. You're negative. You can't. You're not supposed to love me. Mm-hmm. He didn't believe at first when I told him I'm positive. He didn't believe, of course. He said, if it's death, we will just die, both of us. I've just loved you and there's no turning back. I had to take him to the hospital where I was now, my CCC center now.
Yeah.
I told him, I'm not lying. You see, these are my files. And... you shouldn't just leave me alone.
So for you showing him all this, you just wanted to, you know, end this before it goes too far.
Yes, mm-hmm. Yes, yes, yes. Because even if I was in his shoes, okay, if I was negative and a positive person wants to marry me, hell
you
no.
Would think twice.
No, I wouldn't. Mm-hmm. So surprisingly, he just said, I love you and I want you.
Wow.
And your condition doesn't do what?
It doesn't stop
you. Yeah, it doesn't stop me from loving you and I want to marry you. I want to go to see your family. Mm-hmm. See. So he went, saw my dad. My dad asked me, have you told him? I told him yes. He knows. And I'm surprised. Just tell him to leave me alone. Because I'm not ready. Mm-hmm. I don't want. He persisted. Okay, finally we started living together. Okay. Now we had the blessings of our parents. Yes, that was in now 2015. Mm-hmm. We had a baby, a bouncing baby boy.
Nice.
And all this time, he refused to take any prep, any protective method. He refused. You know, I was shocked. Even if it's you, can't you be shocked? Mm-hmm. Somebody is risking his life. Huh? He doesn't care. How? I even thought that maybe he's also positive. He doesn't want to say it, you see. But he was negative. I came to find out he had learned about, he had taken a course about HIV and discordant couples and all that.
So he was aware that you is equals to you.
Yes, he was aware that you is equals to you.
Mm-hmm. And by that we mean undetectable
is equals to untransmittable.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
So he taught me he had to make sure I'm undetectable, you see. Mm-hmm. Yes, within 3 months, I now started taking the medications very seriously.
Yes.
And within 3 months, my viral load was zero. Oh, not zero, literally, but it was undetectable.
Yes,
now. We had a baby, everything was okay. He supported me. This guy really supported me.
Mm-hmm.
Till date, I wonder what kind of a guy is that, because I have never met somebody like that, you know.
Yeah.
So, fast forward now, in 2018,
yeah,
we started having problems in this marriage.
Is there something that changed that year to start the problems?
Okay, my husband. Mm-hmm. The so loving husband, I met some friends. Okay, we moved from Nairobi to Mombasa. Mm-hmm. We moved in the year 2016.
Mm-hmm.
So 2 years down the line, he realized that he doesn't want to be married again.
Oh.
He wants to go back to bachelorhood.
Just like that?
Yes.
You have a child together. You can't undo the child.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I was like, hey, you guy, are you okay? What is it? I thought you wanted this. So now, how can you want to go back to bachelorhood? You're a dad. You cannot go back to that mm-hmm. life. He told me no. After high school, I was taken straight to work. I didn't get to enjoy my youth. So right now, I don't want to get stuck here in marriage. I want to go. I don't want to be questioned every time I go out. If I don't come back, you're there questioning me. I'm sick and tired of that. Just suddenly, mm-hmm. I was like, is it the devil or what? Mm-hmm. Because clearly it was the devil. We were so happy together, yeah? He really loved me. Like, you know, that's something, love is not just words, action.
Yeah.
Action.
And really, he showed you that.
He showed me love. Mm. So, I tried to fight for the marriage, but I couldn't get him to understand. I had to let him go.
Mm.
Yeah, I had to let him go. We separated in 2020.
Okay.
Yeah, 2 years down the line now, after he had started those behaviors, those funny behaviors.
Mm-hmm.
So we parted ways. I had to now start struggling alone myself, but God is good. Yeah.
You have been struggling with your son.
I've been struggling with my son. No sort of help from him, nothing. He decided it's him and Sherehe, him and party, you see? So I had to struggle with my son, but since I'm a hardworking lady, I
You picked up your pieces.
Yeah, I picked up my pieces and I was at least able to give my son at least a good life, not a very good one.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, without a dad, it doesn't remain the same. Things never remain the same, you see.
What kind of work do you do to be able to provide for your child?
Oh, okay. I'm a hairdresser.
Okay.
I have a small salon that I run.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm glad that my work sells itself.
Right.
Yes. I do it with passion. It was just a talent. I found myself knowing how to do hair.
Mm-hmm.
So I do it with passion and it sells. It brings people from far and wide to mm-hmm. come do their hair at my salon. So yeah, that is what has been sustaining us.
Okay.
Yes, but the bottom line here is even mm-hmm. if he changed, at least we were able to live as a discordant couple.
Mm-hmm.
You is equal to you really works.
That's true.
It mm. works. You know, there are people who debate it and say that those are lies.
Mm.
It can
for
never
you
work.
It worked. And actually worked. Many other people we've interviewed before mm-hmm. have proven that as well. So.
Yeah, it works. You can be able to get healthy babies, you have a healthy spouse, your life just continues normally.
Mm-hmm.
HIV is not a death sentence. No, it's not.
Mm-hmm.
But still, even if it's not a death sentence, people out there should be scared. Because if I could reverse it, I would pay anything to reverse it. Yeah? So it's not like I'm advocating for people now to get HIV mm-hmm. since it's not a death sentence. No. You see?
Yeah.
You have to take care of yourself. Stop testing people with eyes out there.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah?
Yeah?
People really test people with eyes. Wanapima na macho.
Na nakagua nasema huyu.
Eh, this one.
Kama hana.
This one has nash. This one has is healthy. You see?
Yeah.
You'll get shocked, my friend. You get shocked. People, so many people here are infected. It's just that they haven't come out. And you know, coming out is a personal decision.
True.
Nobody forced me to come out. Yeah, I just decided inside me, I want to do this. I want to come out. I want to encourage people.
Mm-hmm.
I have seen so many people getting motivated through my story.
Right.
The way I found out how it was eating me inside, how my life changed after disclosure, you yeah. say. When my dad discovered it, that was a life-changing chapter for me.
Mm-hmm.
Because after the acceptance, now I began loving myself more. I began seeing life just the normal way.
Yeah.
I saw, oh, okay, so I can still be loved. I can still work. I can set up a business. I can have a kid. So there's nothing
different
here. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But getting to that acceptance stage and disclosure, it's not easy.
It's true.
You see, him, he found out by mistake. I don't know how I would have broken the news to my dad. I don't know. But my family accepted me.
Yeah.
I'm so grateful for that. They really show me a lot of love. They are my support system. Yes. So right now, if anybody shouts at the top of their voice, Nancy is positive, Nancy is blah, 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 it doesn't get to me.
Because mm-hmm. you've already accepted
it. Yes, I've accepted it and mm-hmm. there's nothing I can do about it. I didn't bring it up to myself. No, what do I have to do about it?
Mm-hmm.
If you have a problem, it's you who has a problem with me. Me, I don't have a problem. Mm-hmm. You see, if you decide to stigmatize me, that's your problem, not mine. Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
And of course, I wouldn't let you just stigmatize me. Why? And this will come as a shock for so many people.
This is the first time you're speaking on a media platform.
Yes. It's the first time I'm speaking on a platform like this.
Mm-hmm.
I know millions and millions of people watch this, and I decided it's the right platform.
Mm-hmm.
They should know HIV doesn't come knocking.
Mm-hmm.
Today I want to knock at Kawira's door.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you know.
Yeah.
It can happen to your sister, your brother, your parents, your friends, anybody.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. It's not like now you have to stigmatize us, you have to shun yourselves away from us. No.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And after all this that has happened in your life, and unfortunately your marriage ended.
Yeah.
Has that dampened your hope to ever try love again? Would you ever wish to start, you know, dating or start another family with yet another person?
Yes. I think I'm not ready.
Okay.
Not that I think, I know. I know for sure I'm not ready.
Yeah.
To date again. It's been 3 years down the line.
Mm-hmm.
So I've gone through the healing process.
Yes.
And now I'm ready.
So yes. If someone comes up and they're willing to continue this journey with you,
yes.
You are open to it.
Yeah, if Mr. Red comes, why not?
Mm-hmm.
Why not?
I like that positivity side, because then people can use some of their past experiences to determine how their future would end up.
Mm-hmm.
So for you, mm-hmm. you're using this as just a platform. You learn something and
yeah.
then you move on.
Mm-hmm.
Looking back to the 15 years when your mom went missing, it's been such a long time.
Mm-hmm.
You do not know where she is. You've
yeah.
never had closure, both you and your, all you and your siblings.
Mm-hmm.
It's been such a long time, and the healing process cannot be complete without knowing exactly what happened.
Yeah.
Is there a message you would want to share with your mom? In case she comes across this video, what would you like her to know from you?
If my mom comes across this video,
yeah.
I'd really love to even get to talk to her, even if she won't come see us one-on-one, at least we need to get closure. What happened, why she had to go, why she had to leave her kids, where she has been all this while,
yeah.
why she had to leave us alone to suffer. We've really suffered, we've really gone through a lot, you know.
Yeah.
Mothers are there. Homemakers, they're the pillars of homes. So you see, all this happened because she left, you see.
Mm-hmm.
So I'd really love, if anybody knows her, okay, her name is Winfrida Nyanchama.
Winfrida Nyanchama.
Yes, yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, by now, she should be 52.
Okay.
So, and people say she's a replica of me.
You look exactly like her.
Yeah.
All right.
So if you see somebody out there who looks like me, please, you can let me know.
They should bring them your way.
Mm-hmm.
Have you tried asking her sisters? Do you still have a relationship with that side of your family?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And what do they know about her?
They say they don't know anything about it.
They also have no contact
with her. Yeah, in fact, whenever we ask, mostly my grandmother, her mother now, she just cries. She breaks down and cries every time she thinks of her.
Mm-hmm.
So I think she doesn't know. Yeah, I think mm-hmm. she doesn't know. So I'd really love to know if she's still alive.
Mm-hmm.
you know you better know that our mom was buried here.
Mm-hmm.
And whenever you miss her, you can go to her grave then not knowing at all where, if this person is alive or dead, you know.
Yeah,
it's so traumatizing.
I agree.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. People get lost for so many years and they come back. So I'm still holding on to the hope that someday she might come back.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
I just hope she's alive. Yeah.
And she's now a grandma.
Yeah, she's a grandma. She should come see her grandkids.
Yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You told me that you have a business in Mombasa,
mm-hmm.
a beauty salon.
Yeah.
How can people, you know, reach you, and what kind of services do you offer at your salon? How can people support your work?
Mm.
All that, tell us.
Okay, my salon is in Mombasa.
Okay.
I have a TikTok page and an Instagram page. Both handles are Nancy the Hairdresser One.
Mm-hmm.
On both TikTok and Instagram.
Okay.
Yeah, on Facebook it's Diva's Salon.
Diva's Salon.
Yeah, Diva's Salon. But
it's located in Mombasa.
Yeah, where? In Mombasa, Bamburi.
Bamburi, Mombasa.
Yeah, but the Facebook page is not very active because most of my clients come from either Instagram or TikTok.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so Nancy the hairdresser one.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, so I advocate for people, don't just, if you test positive, don't just sit down, cry for help. Nobody will come to help you, you know. There are so many other life-threatening diseases like cancer that we should be worried about.
Yeah.
Yeah, at least us, we receive free treatment, free drugs, you know. Mm-hmm. If somebody wants to die,
it's them to choose that.
It's just them to choose. Because now here, the drugs are not sold. They're given freely. Yeah? If you want to die, it will be just be your own choice. Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
So at least some people, I usually get so happy when people follow me and they're like, hey, Nancy, your story has really touched me and it has become a life-changing experience for me. I have started loving myself more from your story. I've started accepting life. I now have the energy, the zeal to continue on with life. So I decided, so my story can change people, mm-hmm. can encourage people, can motivate somebody. So I decided to go public.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Yeah, I decided to just go public. I just motivate people. I don't care who stigmatizes me from now on. Of course, I will lose friends. I will lose some clients. I will lose people. I know.
Mm-hmm. So there's so many people who do not know
yes.
about
this. So many people don't know about it. It's just a few, just a small fraction that know about this. The close people and maybe the people that wanted to date me and I had to disclose, you see.
Mm-hmm.
But so many people don't know about it.
It's really good. Mm-hmm. And the beauty about your story is all the lessons that you've drawn throughout all your experiences, mm-hmm. and you're using them to bring positivity to the world. Anyone who listens to you,
mm-hmm.
they would change their lives for the better, because if Nancy has done it, then I can do it as well. Mm-hmm. You did not tell us, how can people find you?
+254 725 841 273.
Say it again.
+254 725 841 273. That is for calls and for WhatsApp.
Mm-hmm.
+254 780 597 983.
Okay.
Yeah. On social media, on Facebook, you can find me as Nana Nancy.
Mm-hmm.
Nana N-A-N-A Nancy N-A-N-C-Y.
Okay.
On TikTok, it's just my business page. It's my salon page.
Okay.
It's Nancy the Hairdresser 1.
Awesome.
On Instagram also, Nancy the Hairdresser 1.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And that is how they can get in touch with you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
If you're there watching this beautiful story of Nancy, you would like to reach out to her to maybe guide you through your acceptance stage. Now that maybe you have found out about your HIV status, you're wondering where to start, please reach out to her and help her. Let her help you walk this journey of acceptance and living positively, because that is not the end of the world. For those organizations that deal with the stories of people who have discovered that they're HIV positive, to use those stories positively to impact people, you can reach out to Nancy and use her story to spread the positive energy and the positive vibes that are associated with accepting your status. And if you are there, you, Mama Nancy, and you do not know what has been happening in the lives of your children, one of your children is here with us, your firstborn daughter. Reach out to her. Help these children get closure and know if you're okay. Let them know that wherever you are, you're fine and you still love them. Tuko family, thank you so much for staying with us till the end of the show. My name is Yvonne Kawira. Keep it Tuko.